Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the seventh meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting in hybrid format this morning. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items four and five in private. Item four is consideration of evidence, and item five is consideration of a letter on the draft national planning framework, which we will be sending to the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Do we agree to take those items in private?
Yes.
Thank you. That is agreed. Items four and five will be taken in private. For our next item, we welcome members of Scotland's Climate Assembly. We heard from Assembly members back in September, and we were keen to follow up with the Assembly once the Scottish Government responded to the Assembly's report at the end of last year. We note that the Climate Assembly came back together to consider the Scottish Government's response, and the Assembly published a statement last month. So I'm pleased to welcome three members of the Assembly this morning: Ellie Clark, Lewis Elliott and Joan Lawson, members, and Susie Townend, Assembly Secretariat. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for accepting the committee's invitation. It's a delight to have you here. And we have just over an hour for this session, so we will begin with questions. And I believe, Susie, you will allocate questions to the relevant member, if that's okay. Let me start with the first question. One of the issues raised by the Climate Assembly in your statement of response was in relation to the need to retrofit homes across Scotland to reduce carbon emissions. One of your recommendations was the need to see greater clarity and greater detail about what financial assistance would be available to those most in need in terms of retrofitting their homes. In previous evidence sessions at this committee, we have heard the support available is a bit confusing and not widely understood or accessible. I just wonder if that was part of your concerns behind the issue being raised in the statement of response. And Susie, if you could wait just a second until broadcasting unmutes you, that would be great. Yep, you're good to go.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Excellent. I think I might start off by asking Joan just to reflect a little bit on her concerns around fuel poverty and making sure that the poorest were not disadvantaged by the recommendations or indeed by the government response to how they could implement the recommendations. So maybe Joan, you want to start off just by saying a little bit about that. And then I might pass on to Lewis just to come in after Joan. Go ahead, Joan. I think
Fuel poverty was one of the major concerns in our group. We feel there's the hidden poor, the working poor as we called them. People who live just above like means tested benefits, and they're going to be more impacted by fuel poverty. They won't have the money to pay. So it is a real concern. We don't know, but there's not a lot of detail. One of the details we did hear was that perhaps in retrofitting your home, you will be asked, if you've got any equity in your house, you'll be asked to use that for retrofitting, which is quite a scary possibility because there's a lot of people would. Are not in that position. So I think fuel poverty is really important. It's at the forefront, especially with the rise in prices as well. You can see a lot of people panicking about things. And I did have an example. My mother was lived in a single end in Glasgow, and they got electricity put in 1948, and were told it would never increase in price. So she's a bit miffed it has. But I can pass this on, if that's okay.
Great. Thanks very much, Joan. Lewis, do you want to say something more on the retrofitting?
Yeah, just briefly, that I think the consensus was, or several people mentioned in the Assembly, that the various schemes and grants through which financial assistance can be provided to retrofit homes were already difficult enough to qualify for in terms of meeting the requirements to receive that financial assistance. But in addition, there was another barrier, which was knowing about which schemes are available for where you live. So there's the kind of the two-tiered barrier for that, first qualifying for it, but before even that, being able to be aware of those schemes. And there are charities and NGOs that are trying to make to spread awareness of those and to get those to the people who need them. But ideally, we'd have more assistance for the government in making people who need those schemes aware of them.
Great. Thanks, Lewis. I think the only thing that I would add to that from the members was that members were very keen to see retrofitting. So it was very much a strong recommendation, but they absolutely saw it as a way to address fuel poverty, that they saw investing in insulation and helping people with insulation, and they talked about various grants that could be made available, would mean that people wouldn't have to spend as much on fuel. And so it was very much focused both on climate change, but also on addressing fuel poverty. I hope that covers the question sufficiently.
Absolutely. Thank you. Those responses were very helpful, and we completely understand the concerns raised. Retrofitting and the heat in buildings policy is an area this committee has been focusing on through our local government inquiry, and it is an area that we will continue to focus on. It's a massive part of the climate change targets we have in Scotland, and the decarbonisation of heat is one of the big challenges we face across all aspects of the policy. So that's definitely your concerns in this area are shared by the committee. The second question I had was again on your statement of response, which highlighted that we would like to see a clearer roadmap. We want the Scottish Government to commit to more specific actions and targets so that we are able to hold them to account for delivery of climate change targets. Again, that's very much aligned with evidence this committee has heard from the UK Climate Change Committee, local authorities and others. I wonder if you could be quite helpful if you could provide us with examples of where you think more detail is required. If you looked at a climate change policy or targets and you thought that we agree with the target, we agree with this policy, but we need, you know, a roadmap, we understand what the destination is, but we need a bit more detail or much more detail in terms of how to get there and what it means, you know, for what it means for everyone in society.
Thank you very much indeed for that question, Convener. I think I'll ask Ellie to start off, perhaps particularly talking about some of the areas that she's concerned about, where she perhaps felt there wasn't a sufficiently clear roadmap, and then pass round to Elliot and then back to Joan.
Hi there. Hi. One of the areas that I looked into in the work stream that I was in was diet and lifestyle. And it's just astonishing how impacting the diet habits of the nation have had on the carbon emissions as a country. And I think that there could be a lot more detail in looking at the changes that we can make with diet and lifestyle to be able to and enable to monitor that. Well, one of the recommendations that we felt was a really good short-term quick win recommendation was the recommendation 26, and that was for the government to have a committed leading by example in public procurements of food in public and also public education campaign for sustainable diets. And that was recommendation 39. We felt like that was something that could be monitored quite immediately. We know that agriculture and food are responsible for about 18% of Scottish greenhouse emissions. So if you start with a figure like that and then you start implementing this change, which would be the government setting precedent and allowing people to take a culture shift away from high carbon foods. I think that could be something we felt could take immediate effect. It didn't need investment, it didn't need technological exploration. It was something that could immediately be put into effect. And I know that speaking to parliamentarians that the document for public procurement is being reviewed this year, and so it's kind of at a stage where changes can take place immediately. And if even over a year, if that could then be monitored in a year's time, and looking at the government itself and its public procurement, you could quite easily, I think, quantify the changes that have happened within the public body. And then there's also the long-term effects that that will have on the culture change of people changing their diet habits that would have across a bigger scale. So I think that's something that could be easily monitored if it was set as a precedent and practiced as a prototype within the public structures. It could quite tangibly be monitored as well, but also projected into how the impacts of that across the nation, making that huge change in diet habits.
Thank you very much indeed, Eri. I'm going to maybe pass across to Lewis to talk next about some of the things where you would have liked to have seen a more detailed set of timelines or more immediate targets. And I know that you wanted to talk a little bit about packaging, and maybe that's one of the things that you would like to reference here.
Yeah. So I was just trying to look for an example. The one that I found here is the response to Recommendation 35 about food carbon labelling. The recommendation had a timescale of within 5 years to have fully implemented the food's carbon labelling system. And in the government response, we've got that... the government supports the recommendation in principle and are committed to exploring the feasibility of implementing food carbon labelling. And the response from the government really lacks the same urgency that we were trying to get across by putting a specific timeframe on the recommendation. And I understand that in order to do feasibility studies, it doesn't make sense to put an absolute end date on the project, but it would have been very helpful and encouraging to see an estimated, you know, date for the results of that feasibility study to come up. Because even just knowing where we're going for the next step helps us to, you know, be on the same page in terms of where we're going longer term. In terms of talking about food packaging, I'm not sure I've got any ready examples that will be relevant to this question, so I'm happy to pass over to the next person.
Don't worry. Thank you very much indeed for that, Lewis. Maybe Joan, is there anything that you felt that you particularly wanted to see a more specific timescale on? Or the other thing which you might want to reference is around public transport and supporting the Oyster Card recommendation, where I think we wanted to see something a bit more urgent than has been agreed by government in their initial response. Let me pass to Joan and see whether you want to say anything on this.
Sure. One of the things I was looking at was retrofitting again, and we had asked if it could be done by 2030. And this again is a personal experience. We tried to get it would have brought us up to Passive House standards in our house insulation, and we can't get MD in Scotland to do that. So that's a great worry that there's nobody available, and the companies in England aren't willing to come up and help out. But I think overall, I think I was a wee bit disappointed with the government's, you know, response, and I feel we'd like to hold them accountable for the things that they said they would do as an assembly, and we'd like to check up on them in a year's time to make sure things are going the way we hoped they would go. I don't know if that helps.
That's super, Joan. Thank you. Thank you very much for that. I'm sure we'll come back to a little bit more detail about what we would like to see going forward. But maybe I could just add to what the members have said around the public transport recommendations. the Assembly members made a recommendation to have an Oyster card, and I know this is something which Scottish Government has been talking about for some time, and I think members felt that the response slightly missed the motivation behind the recommendation. The Assembly members really wanted to see a much more integrated, joined up way of moving across between different types of transport and from one bus, for example, to another, and to be able to make it cheaper, particularly for low income families, that there would be a mechanism for doing that. And I think the response was much more focused on seeing the Oyster card as being a way of paying, rather than seeing the kind of underlying principles around making it more attractive, much easier to use public transport, and therefore having that nudge to get people out of cars and onto public transport. And so I think quite often the government response, which members did say they were grateful for, it was certainly a very considered response, it was a detailed response, and so they were very grateful to the government for really engaging on that level, but they did feel that there had been perhaps a lack of ambition and urgency, and perhaps a lack of kind of thinking behind what the members were trying to get in terms of the response coming back from government. But I'll pass back to you, convener, for the next question for the members.
Thank you very much. Those were very, very helpful responses. You raised a number of points. I think good points on the Oyster cards and the challenging 2030 targets for retrofitting, which, again, this is something all of those issues are something and issues the committee will be looking at. I know that other members of the committee want to come in and explore some of these areas. So let me hand over to Fiona Hislop to be followed by Monica Lennon.
I refer members to my declaration of interest. I'm a member of the stewarding group for the Climate Assembly. Good morning and thank you for joining us, everyone. The Climate Assembly makes a very strong statement, and it says, we believe from the Scottish Government's response to our recommendations for action that government needs to think less about what they can't do and instead demonstrate a positive attitude, thinking hard about how they can make things happen. But the government's response was actually responding to recommendations from the Climate Assembly itself. And a load of those recommendations, particularly those, the latter ones, are in areas where the Scottish Government doesn't have powers, but the Westminster Government does. So my question is, I know you were informed by lots of expertise in different areas. Were you quite clear as to what the Scottish Government had responsibility for and not? Or do you think that, and was that a deliberate action that you deliberately recommended things that the Scottish Government couldn't take action on? And then the second thing is, when you say that they should think hard about how they can make things happen, is that in the areas that they do have responsibility on, or are you asking the Scottish Government to try and have impact on the things that are still reserved to Westminster?
Thank you for that, Fiona. I think I'll go to Ellie first on this to answer those questions. Ellie, do you want to have a shot at answering those?
Yeah, I think we were aware of some of the devolved matters. I think there's also this kind of overriding hope that the climate emergency is such a huge overarching issue that affects UK, Scotland, the whole world. Despite there being some barriers to making changes in policy and in law, that the Scottish Government might have some leverage in influencing or influencing UK government, speaking with a louder voice of representing its people as a strong voice, as leaders, and also looking to the future of times when we do have these powers in, if we, you know, when we do have independence, or, you know, looking beyond the horizons of what we're limited to in a political realm of today, but thinking just with a more aspirational, inspirational eye, really. I think that's what we were hoping, looking to our leaders for in this response. It felt a little bit dampening down. It felt a little bit like everything was staying within its comfort zone. But the lack of inspiration, I think, was something we were identifying. And in our statement of ambition, we really, I think, communicates the kind of what it is we're looking for as a citizens' assembly, and we didn't feel like that was picked up on in the responses. Some more ambition, more zest, more determination that we can work through this. Felt like that was lacking. We understand that there are issues that are devolved, but it kind of seemed to focus on the can't do than what we can do, what we were trying to get across.
Thank you very much, Ellie. Lewis, I saw you nodding when Fiona was asking the question. I don't know whether you want to come in and add anything to what Ellie has already said, or...
Yeah, I'd love to. I'd echo what Ellie says there, and I think there was an acknowledgement throughout the Assembly that joined up thinking is one of the most important things to have a meaningful strategy of how we're going to get from where we are now to net zero. And that doesn't just mean within the sectors of Scottish industry or within the systems like transport and food and whatnot, but that also means within the halls of power, as it were. And I think that although we were aware broadly of which powers are devolved and reserved, we also, especially in our statement of ambition, we expect the Scottish Government to exercise its responsibility as a nation within the UK to have those lines of communication with the UK Government and to express the interests of the people of Scotland on issues that are not devolved powers, on how we expect the UK Government to use those reserve powers in the interest of Scotland as one of the nations of the UK. And in addition, when we talk about imaginative and innovative ways of getting things done, one of the examples of that was looking at climate change as a health issue, kind of a human rights thing. With one of the examples I think I can remember was the clean air and the having the right to breathe clean air, because we realised that the Scottish Government didn't have the powers to tackle that as a climate issue, but when considering it as a health issue, that could be thought of in terms of devolved powers. And then, you know, that kind of outside of the box thinking enables a lot more action when you come at the problem from that direction.
Thank you very much indeed, Lewis. And I would just add that there was this strong desire, particularly that came to me from the statement that came out of Weekend 8, to see better working across all levels of government, including local authorities and devolved administrations and with the UK government. And just as Lewis was saying, that frustration that perhaps there could have been a little bit more creativity in responding. So perhaps the taxation power on fuel doesn't sit with the Scottish Government, but there are other things which they could have done, which would have encouraged the same sort of response. And so I think just in the tone of this response, to have looked behind the recommendations to see what the members really wanted and then engaged creatively with those, rather than, I think members sometimes felt that it was often used as a bit of an excuse. And as Ellie said so eloquently just now, there may come a time when that can't be an excuse, and so they would like to see what government could do in future. I'll pass back to Fiona.
Thank you for your perspective. Clearly the Assembly has done great service to the people of Scotland and indeed beyond in your work, but the formal work of the Assembly ended with your weekend, your final weekend. So what process is in place for further engagement deliberation, if any, and how does the Assembly propose to monitor the outcome of its work and continue to hold the government to account for delivery of its recommendations? That's a challenge if it doesn't exist. But I'm also conscious that this is the second time that the Climate Assembly has given evidence to this committee, the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Are there any specific things that you think the Climate Assembly would ask of the Parliament or indeed of this committee in taking forward the work and indeed the monitoring, the accountability that some of your members have already referred to?
Thank you for that, Fiona. I think Lewis, probably based on the conversations that he had with other Assembly members a couple of nights ago, might want to start off with that, and then I'll pass to Joan.
Yeah, so we've been discussing just recently in what form the Climate Assembly will continue and how it's going to change and adapt to its new role of holding the government to account based on the commitments the government's made and in their response to our report. And for me, one of the most important parts of that is creating a network where the members of the Assembly who want to continue in this new role will be able to reach out to independent climate experts, the media, and also the government, and especially committees like the Net Zero Committee. And to respond to new developments in climate policy as they come up, especially relating to the recommendations and goals that we set out in our report. And how exactly that's going to be done is still under discussion, but we're looking into getting funding the facilitation of the meetings of the Climate Assembly in the same way that it's been done by the NGO that's been helping us out, Involve, I believe they're called.
Thank you very much. Joan, do you want to come in and maybe say a little bit about particularly the children and how the children could continue to be involved in that interaction between the children and the adults going forward?
Absolutely. I mean, it's a big thing that we want to hold the government accountable. We want to check. I mean, it's just being nosy, really. We want to check up they're doing their thing. I was so lucky to work with the Children's Parliament, and the children were amazing. Their recommendations were astounding. They didn't hold anything back. And I think the children also want to see the government accountable. We had a meeting, and you know, one of them's talking about storming government and things, but you know, I feel quite proud of everything we've done, and I think everything the kids, have, you know, the children have done is amazing. I'd hate for that just to be wasted and nothing to happen. But really, it's really important because the children were so imaginative, you know, and I think they were a bit more daring than the adults. They had that kind of freedom. And it would be such a shame to lose any of this. I think it's really important.
Thank you very much, Joan. The other thing that you mentioned was this idea about being a resource and having been through that learning journey as members of the Assembly. And I think you made a rather generous offer. I don't know if you want to repeat it in the committee of being available to sense check things. Do you want to say a little bit about that?
Sure. I mean, education is key. When I started this journey, I knew nothing and was in an absolute panic the first weekend because I thought, oh no, what have I done? But I used to work as a careers advisor and I used to work in the job centre. And I mean, the whole idea of no one's left behind is key. And about, you know, talking about the different careers that are going to be available and educating the country. And I says, use us. That's, you know, we're just ordinary people that have learned over 8 weeks about climate change. So use us to speak to people and to talk to people and tell them about what our experience was and what's happening in the world. And I still offer that.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed, Joan. And maybe I'll just pass that to Ellie, maybe to say a little bit more about the idea of a scorecard with 10 key performance indicators and also a system for holding government to account, and maybe whether Ellie, you see any role for the committee going forward in assisting the members to do that. I'll pass to Ellie.
Yeah, well, first of all, I just wanted to express the kind of the position that we now feel in, and I'm talking about the majority of us as Assembly members, but I think we all feel like we've been through this incredible journey of learning, and ordinary citizens, we are now in a different place to where we were a year ago. And I mean, almost looking at the recommendations, I feel like they need to be updated again because the urgency has needed to be picked up. But one of the questions that I've asked a lot of the ministers during this process of talking about our recommendations is what are the main barriers that hold government back from acting with the urgency that we think is necessary, we know is necessary? And speaking to Patrick Harvey and Humza Yousef in particular, they learned about the barriers of public uptake and public will. And I think what we kind of can show and be useful moving forward as a citizens' assembly is, as ordinary citizens, having been exposed to the facts and the evidence and the reality of the situation, that our leaders do not need to worry about public will and uptake from informed citizens. And this is why the education aspect and the public information is so important, because with information, people can make the informed decisions, and we don't need to worry about that as a barrier. And I hope that moving forward as a citizens' assembly, we can facilitate and help government to be that voice of confidence, to speak on behalf of the collective of the citizens of Scotland, so that we can reassure that we are ready, we would be ready. And if the majority of people did have this knowledge, then they would be ready as well to move forward. And so it is important that we have something tangible to move forward with. So idea of this 10 key performance indicators is quite important to so it would be decided by independent experts, but it could be something that the Citizens Assembly facilitate and oversee, but it would have clear numerical measurable targets, so that we can also meet back on an annual basis and really clearly be able to interrogate and oversee what it is that's being done. And the next 10 years are so critical, and we're hearing from the IPCC, we're hearing from the Climate Health Alliance. You know, this is really, climate change is the greatest health threat to humanity in the 21st century. And like it is something that we have to really make a difference in the next 10 years. So over the next coming years and incrementally, and using this these measurable targets is really important. And that's something that the Assembly hopefully help out with, working in partnership with government.
Thank you very much indeed, Ellie. And I think just from a secretariat perspective, I would just like to emphasise how impressive the commitment of members has been, that they started this process almost a year and a half ago, and they're still committed to an ongoing dialogue with government, but there isn't a clear mechanism to allow that to happen going forward. And so I would really be grateful for any support that this committee can give in supporting the members with their very clear desire to remain engaged and to continue dialogue and to continue to hold the government to account going forward.
Well, it's quite clear the Climate Assembly is not going anywhere. It's going into the future. And obviously, we're not the government, we're the Parliament. But if there is anything that your members in continuing form and networking want to do in relation to the committee and to the Parliament, I'm sure that if we can keep in contact, that might be something that the convener might want to consider, along with committee members, as to what role this committee would have in that. But on that note, I'll pass back to the convener.
Great, Fiona. Thank you very much. Next up, Monica Lennon, to be followed by Mark Ruskell, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everyone. And I agree with our deputy convener. The work you're doing is fantastic, and we hope to have ongoing engagement and dialogue with you. And your challenge to us as parliamentarians and to the government is so important. I really agree with the points made about the contribution that the children have made. They are fantastic, and I've been out and about locally speaking to schools, and I think children really get that this is about climate justice, but also about social justice. So I was really interested by the comments, I think, from Ellie and Lewis about food a few moments ago, and from speaking to young people when I do school visits, they're very active collecting food donations for local food banks and charities. They're very aware of poverty and of food poverty, but they're also very aware of the amount of food that is wasted, even within their own schools, and they feel very frustrated by that. So I just wonder how the Assembly feels that we can better address that. I know other parts of the world have legislation that effectively tries to ban food waste and has quite serious measures. Is there more that you think we can do in Scotland to really reduce food waste?
I'll let Ellie start off and then I'll pass to Lewis.
Thank you for the question, Monica. I think food and it's our personal choices. There's so much that informs our choice of our personal diet. And I think the system, the food system that we're currently in is a broken one. And I think we need to rethink the whole way of how we feed ourselves as a nation. There's excess eating, which leads to obesity and ill health, and it's a burden on the NHS. The types of food that we're eating are not good for the climate, they're not good for ourselves. And there's evidence to say that if we eat for a healthier climate, we're going to be eating for a healthier nation as well. So I think there's a whole kind of shift in the way that Scotland needs to perceive its own diet. And I think, again, we go back to knowledge and education, which is so important for people to make informed choice, and that needs to be accessible to all. And one of the recommendations that we keep stressing, that we're disappointed with the response that we gained from the Scottish Government, is recommendation number 39, which is public education campaign about sustainable diets. And this is something that the Children's Assembly also felt really strongly about. And if you don't have the information, you can't make the right choices. And if there's a public campaign around sustainable diets, I think that would include food waste. It would include eating the right amounts of food in the right way, and it would have huge influence. And I think the government has a lot of leverage to change the psyche, because it is a culture change. And I've already mentioned recommendation number 26, which again, we're really disappointed that this wasn't uptaken by the response that we received. And you know, there's huge power in public procurement that Scottish government have control over, and that if you changed public canteens to be sustainable diets, you're giving out a clear message, you're setting precedent, and you're setting a prototype, demonstrating how we can eat healthily as a nation. And it, for some people, it would only be one meal a day. It wouldn't even be that. But if it's a clear message coming from the top down, people are going to listen to that. And if it's accompanied by this education campaign as well, I just see this being, the Assembly's felt strongly that this is a quick win that is kind of easy to adopt. But yeah, disappointed that we haven't had that take of that one.
Thank you very much, Ellie. Maybe to pass on to Lewis, who wanted to also talk about this.
Yeah, I would agree with what Ellie said there. In addition, our recommendation 3 about food packaging is really essential to tackle the issue of food waste. And we're disappointed with the government's response in this area particularly. So it's about perishable foods being sold in large amounts, because I think the key with any effective change that is brought in based on our recommendations is that it has to target the decision-making points of the relevant parties. So in the case of the supermarkets who are selling large numbers of fruit and vegetables that will go off reasonably quickly in big bags and not selling them individually loosely, then the the rhetoric behind the decision from their point of view is, well, if we package them together, we don't give the consumer any choice about whether they can buy only one or buy the large quantity. They're going to buy the large quantity because it's the only way to get the food that they want. And then the waste isn't our problem because it happens in their home. If they eat one or two of those fruits and then the rest of them go off before they're used, that waste isn't something that the supermarket is considering. And so I think legislating against, or legislating to make sure that options are available to buy those perishable goods in loose single quantities, to give the consumer that control over what is or isn't wasted in their home, is an incredibly important thing, which has sadly been missed out of the response that we got from the government.
Thank you very much indeed, Lewis. And I think when members made the original recommendation that you were just talking about, one of the things that they were thinking about was reducing the food waste by, if you have to buy six apples in a packet rather than buying an individual apple, but also you're having to pay for six apples rather than one apple, which obviously is more expensive and goes back to what Ellie was talking about in terms of making sustainable, good quality foods affordable. And so I think that just points to the way members really thought in a very holistic way. They were asked to think about climate change, but they were also thinking about how they could make Scotland better going forward, and it was very comprehensive. I'll pass back to Monica in case she has further questions on that.
Thank you very much. Very grateful for those responses. You've certainly given us food for thought. And I think there are things that government can do, but also there's clearly a lot we can do as members of the public to really put pressure on retailers as well. I wanted to return to public transport, because I know you've got some really, really important and really good recommendations and a lot that we could get on and do right now. And we had a session with some of the children from the Children's Parliament last week, and they also made points about just making it easier to read and navigate around timetables. I think that really fits in with what you say about the Oyster card, about just making it easier. And I think we would all agree with that. I think it was Joan earlier on that talked about, you know, people on lower incomes and people who just miss out from benefits. So I'm just wondering, in the context of public transport, what are your ideas around making public transport more affordable and more accessible for as many people as possible? I'm aware of a campaign right now, Everyone Aboard, which is trying to extend the national concessionary scheme to people 26 and under and people on low income and on benefits. But when you have a line in the sand, there's always someone who misses out. So I'd be keen to hear what kind of model you think would work, or we could work towards to make sure that people are not priced out of public transport.
I think I'll pass to Joan to start this one off.
Thanks for the question. I think it's really difficult because, you know, benefits, a lot of benefits are means tested, but again, there are people, my experience from working in the job centre is there's a lot of people just missed out. So we doing a means tested, like low income, you'd really need to think about it and kind of have a cut off of like how much money people earn a year. It's not going to be easy. I think that's going to be really, really difficult to make it fair. I mean, it's great that they've done like the free transport for you know, for young people. But also, I mean, I think a lot of the time there's not highlighted that other people are eligible for free transport, like disabled and things. Going back to education again, and you know, I honestly don't envy the government in this, but it's going to be very difficult to make fair.
Thank you very much indeed, Joan. And I think what the members said in their statement was that they really welcomed the fact that under 22s are now able to use public transport free, as can older people, but that they I'd really expected when they made their recommendation that the provision would be much wider, and particularly, you know, as Joan was referencing, for the working poor, people who perhaps are just missing out on a whole lot of things, and actually it's those people that we really need to be helping to get onto public transport. Monica, did you want to come back on that question at all?
I'm watching time in the convener's eye, but I suppose briefly related to that, you know, we want to make it more affordable, but I know in my local community and across many parts of Scotland, the service just doesn't exist. You know, bus routes have gone, it's not easy to use public transport. So just if you've got any comments to make on how we can make sure that we do have good public transport right across the country, particularly in rural and island communities as well.
I think I'll pass to Ellie to talk from her own experience on that, because I know that she lives in a rural area. Ellie.
Hello, thanks Monica for that question. I'm a cyclist myself, and I've recently moved to the Scottish borders, and I'm finding it really difficult to travel in a sustainable way, and maybe that's my fault for moving to a rural area, but it's made me realise the community around me really don't have options available. There's no bus service on a Sunday, there's inconvenient timings for evenings, and again, this kind of integration of public transport doesn't seem to. There's certain bus timetables that work in an area, but then to get the bus to Edinburgh, it doesn't sync together. And there's also other things in this area that I think could improve on, and encouraging active transport with more facilities for bikes on buses. There's a lot of systems here that just aren't working to support that. But I also look like, again, this kind of idea that Scotland could be really leading the way and looking at some of these issues with a more aspirational eye, and companies in Europe that, you know, public transport's free to everybody, and we not kind of raise our horizons of aspiration and not get caught up in the nitty-gritty of like who can and who can't and what's fair, and just let's open to everybody. And the amount of dependency on private car use will go down, it makes it fairer and more effective. And that was the kind of question that we were posed as a climate assembly, is how can we change and tackle the climate emergency in a fair and effective way? And I just feel for fair and effective way, let's public transport, let's aim for it to be open and accessible and free to all. And tax could be coming from private car use and carbon emissions from that.
Thank you, Ellie.
Thank you very much indeed, Ellie. I think that was a real message that I took away from the Assembly, which perhaps surprised me a little, was the members recognised, as Joan said, how difficult it is for government, but how ambitious they were and how prepared they were to tax areas which they felt were not helping Scotland in terms of climate or the wider societal benefits, in order to support the things which they felt were really important, like providing good and affordable or free public transport.
Thank you very much, Susie, and thank you, Ellie, for being so honest and being a very strong advocate of active travel and public transport. And please don't apologise or apportion blame to yourself for moving to a rural area. We need to hear the voice of rural Scotland too, so thank you very much.
Great, thank you very much, Monica. Next up is Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Mark, please.
Yeah, thanks very much. And can I just thank you all for your incredible climate leadership. I have to say, as a politician sitting on this side of the table, it's pretty humbling, and that's how it should be, I think. So, you know, keep up the good work. I was talking to some members of the French Climate Citizens Assembly when they were in Glasgow at the COP. And one of the things that they're doing, I think, is working quite closely with the French government on a number of areas of policy going forward. So I wondered if that was something that the Scottish Assembly had actually discussed. Are there particular priority areas where you feel that you want to go a lot further in terms of working directly with the government, whether that's retrofitting or public transport or other areas, and how you'd want to do that. What kind of level of engagement do you feel you're able to have going forward?
I think conversations are still at a reasonably early stage, but I will see if Lewis wants to come in on that.
Yes, thank you for the question. I would certainly be excited to have conversations at any level possible with governments on policy. And in terms of the ongoing role of the Climate Assembly, we're likely to see some reduction in membership based on the new form, whatever that might be, that the Assembly will take. We don't know how much that'll be quite yet. But when we know how many people we've got left, there's also a question of whether individually we might want to specialise a bit more. Because obviously, although we've been discussing a broad range of issues, individually, some things resonate with some members more than others. And one thing that I think might be exciting and interesting would be to have certain members of the Climate Assembly network with some climate experts to really increase their knowledge and awareness of certain issues to a greater depth than we were able to do during the kind of the first run of the Climate Assembly, and then use that as an inroads to more in-depth discussions on certain items of policy with the relevant parts of the government and the parliament.
Thank you very much indeed, Lewis. I'll let Ellie come in a moment, but I just wanted to let you know, Mark, that actually, based on one of the conversations that we had with the ministers over the summer, the minister's team reached out from education to say that they would like to talk to some of our members about education, because they were bringing their lived experience as teachers. And actually, at lunchtime today, a couple of our members are meeting with officials in education to talk about how to integrate climate change learning much more into the curriculum, bringing that experience both of being an Assembly member and of being a teacher. And I think we would really encourage more of that going forward. What we need to do is make sure that we have a mechanism for officials and ministers to be able to reach out to the Assembly members, and we haven't quite got that sorted yet. But I'll pass to Ellie to see if she wants to say anything more about that.
Yeah, thanks for that question, Mark. I think as an Assembly, we'd be very interested in learning from other Assemblies around the world, especially the Climate Assemblies, and maybe forming links. Feel like we're part of a greater whole, because this is a global crisis that we're in. And that's interesting that the French Citizens Assembly are working more with the government on more focused topics. I think there's definitely scope for that. I think we just had our very initial meeting after the official assembly has finished, and we are in a situation now where there's no funding to support the continuation of the assembly, and we do think that it's important that we continue to be supported with some kind of facilitation, and also working with experts we think is very important, so that we are updated with the latest evidence, and that we are still managing to hone back in on the original question of working in a fair and effective way. I think to hold our kind of integrity and our authority as a collective voice, we need to continue our own kind of knowledge journey and being informed. We're not experts at all, we're just general regular citizens, so we will need some kind of framework that will hold us in this space for us to continue our work effectively. And I ask the committee now what can be available in terms of funding for that. We're also, you know, householders, we have families, I've got a little two-year-old, we all have a pressure on time too. So there's a limit to what we can commit. We obviously want to give as much as we possibly can, but there needs to be a framework to make that feasible for us to continue the work.
Thank you very much indeed, Ellie. And then just finally to Chuan, perhaps to talk about how we can perhaps continue to engage with the children going forward and have the children part of those conversations with government.
Yeah, I think that would be it would be a great benefit if we could incorporate the Children's Parliament along with the adults. I haven't actually, I missed the meeting they had about taking the Climate Assembly forward. And I think it's of vital importance that we do and we continue to check up. But having the children involved brings a bit of fun, which is also, you know, it's great. And as I've said it loads of times, I must be boring you senseless, but their enthusiasm and their zest for change, and it's just inspiring. And if we could keep that going alongside the adults, I think we'd be doing a really good job. But it's how do we do this?
I think it's not just the children who are inspiring, Joan. I think it's all the Assembly members. But I'll pass back to Mark and let him come in again.
Yeah, I think we've all been inspired by the work of the Children's Parliament. And it's just a creativity that young people have as well. They often see links that we don't necessarily do. I had a sort of one detailed question I wanted to ask you, and that was around some of your recommendations on aviation. And I wanted to ask just around some of the tax options with that. So, you know, is it your view that, say, a frequent flyer tax could be brought in and that could operate alongside an air departure tax? Or did you have thoughts about how the air departure tax should be changed to apply that to frequent flyers? So again, I guess this is an area where we could go into quite a lot of depth, and it's maybe for a longer conversation with government. But given the work you've done on this at the moment, I just wondered if you had any emerging thoughts about how we change that tax regime for particularly frequent flyers.
Ellie, do you want to come in and initiate on that?
To be honest, the whole kind of concept of flight travel, after everything that we've learned from the Climate Assembly and the situation that we're in at the moment, it just seems like it's history. And I find it difficult to even kind of grapple with fairness of taxes, with the luxury of people being able to fly, take short flights. I mean, they absolutely should not be congratulated for frequent flying, which is, we all know, damaging and adding to the carbon emissions hugely, and I find it almost exacerbating to even have conversations about flight travel when we're trying to reduce the carbon footprint on micro levels. And sorry, I'm a bit perplexed with that one. I can't really add more to it,
do you want to come in and say something, maybe particularly about, you know, recognizing absolutely what Ellie has said, but also that Scotland is now a very diverse nation with lots of new Scots who do have family around the world, and the original recommendation suggested that perhaps people could have their first flight without having to pay additional taxes, but once you were doing lots of travelling, then there would be an incremental taxation scale to really discourage that, and particularly to discourage business travel. Do
you want
to say anything a bit more about that?
Yeah, one of the ideas we discussed was a kind of a banded emissions allowance system where for your first flight, depending on its length, you wouldn't pay additional tax. After you've flown a certain distance, the tax would be increased. I'll be the first one to put my hands up and say I don't exactly understand the current system of taxation. But I do wholeheartedly support, as does most of the Assembly, I would expect, the principle of taxing frequent flyers more than occasional flyers, and making alternative options available, particularly for people who have family abroad, to make access to high quality internet speeds for conference calling, things like that, to make both business and family reasons for traveling, to have alternatives that don't involve the huge emissions that come with the air travel. And I'd also like to say, in terms of the government's response to some of our recommendations around air travel, with regards to frequent flyers, the idea in one of our recommendations of eliminating or banning frequent flyer bonuses or air mile bonuses was pretty much ignored. And the Assembly was very disappointed in that, because we see that as another one of the easy, high impact, easy wins that could have a major change on the culture around flying and the decisions that go into that, by making it a less attractive option to people who use that as their current solution for business travel or seeing their families. And I hope that the committee will discuss and encourage the government to discuss options for eliminating those frequent flyer bonuses.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, Lewis. And then finally, perhaps to point forward to what Joan has said throughout around education, that the members also wanted to have clear labelling of the carbon impact of flying, and indeed of all travel, so that people were able to make choices. At the moment, we heard even from one of the ministers that we spoke to that they weren't entirely sure whether it was better to go by train or by car or by plane. And really what we need to do is to be able to present that very clearly to people, so that then people can make the choices. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Mark, a couple of supplementals in this area. Jackie Dunbar and then Liam Kerr. Jackie, please.
Good morning, panel. It was in regards to what you were just discussing about the frequent flyer levies and increasing the ADT. I was just wondering if the Assembly had considered the just transition impacts of implementing these, especially for the Highlands and Islands, because sometimes that is their only mode of transport sometimes.
Yeah, I mean, definitely the Assembly did consider it, and one of the recommendations was around investment in low carbon flight as well, particularly with an eye to the island communities and those critical services which will continue to rely on flight. And so members were not suggesting that there should be no flights between the islands and the mainland, but they were thinking about how they could reduce the carbon impact. So they were very concerned about that, and I would say that we had members from the island communities who were able to speak to that from their personal experience. But I don't know whether, Joan, you want to say anything more to Jackie on that.
No, I don't.
No, that's okay. Jackie, is that sufficient? Would you like a bit more detail?
Not really, because to be quite honest, you're answering the questions very, very fully today, and it's much appreciated. But when we talk about flying, sometimes we always think abroad, and it's not always the case. But I am very thankful to the panel today for their answers.
Thank you. Jackie, Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask the panel to follow up on what I thought was Jackie's very good question. I'm just going to press you for a little more detail on that, please, because I hear the proposals, but what did the Assembly conclude would be the practical impacts of proposals such as a frequent flyer levy or increasing ADT on jobs, on the ability of the lower paid to fly, and on connectivity for places such as Highlands and Islands, and somewhere that Jackie and I will be very concerned about, the North East? So what did the Assembly conclude would be the practical impacts of these policies?
The Assembly were very aware that there will be options in that change, just and fair, and that no area and no community should be left behind. And I think you've heard very powerfully from Joan and from the others about how they have really thought very hard about people on low incomes. And so I wouldn't want you to think that they hadn't taken account of that. And that's why some of the recommendations around flying were around thinking about we can have the first flight available so people can see their relatives, that we do make exceptions for emergency flights for the islands. But that doesn't mean that we can continue to behave as we have. And I think you heard very powerfully from Ellie that there do have to be changes. But John, do you want to come in a little bit more talking about the process of making sure that nobody is left behind and speaking to some of the concerns that Liam has just raised?
Yeah, sure. It's going to be a difficult process. It's like with with public transport as well. I think it's going to be hard to make sure that no one is left behind. It's going to be really difficult, but we're going to have to kind of, as Lewis was saying, like balancing it out with good internet connectivity, like people who have family abroad keeping it away. But we didn't want to put any barriers in place to people travelling, but again, it's a difficult one. It is.
Thank you very much indeed, Julian. I would just say that one of the areas where the members particularly recognised that the government had made significant progress was in the area of skills and reskilling and providing education for people to move from the carbon intensive industries into the greener industries, things like investing in skills for retrofitting, as well as encouraging people to retrofit. And so that was an area where I think the Assembly really felt that the government had made quite a significant response. And that perhaps speaks to some of your concerns around what happens to those areas and those individuals who are at the moment in industries which there will be less of and perhaps ultimately none going forward. What happens to them to make sure that they're not left behind?
Great, thank you very much. Liam, let me bring in Natalie Dawn, please.
Nice to see you all this morning. You've answered the questions really fully, so I'm just going to pick up on a couple of points that are sticking out to me. I'd like to focus on the Assembly's response to the Sustainable Diet public information campaigns. I know that it was noted that you feel the Scottish Government has been inadequate. And what new initiatives and public information campaigns you would recommend. Following on from that, I also want to just add in, I think that despite those who are informed and those who are aware of the situation and making more sustainable choices, it's not always possible for people who are on low incomes. And we've kind of touched on that already this morning in terms of talking about bulk packaging and things in our shops. So I'm just wondering if the Assembly have any other ways or ideas that we can open up choices for everyone.
Thank you. I'll pass to Ellie on this because I'm conscious of time.
We considered that quite deeply, and we looked at tax on high carbon foods, which will allow less carbon heavy foods like organic fruits and vegetables become more readily available. It seems an unfair system that we have at the moment in our food system, that only wealthy people, only some people can afford the healthy food options, and that we feel is completely unjust. And this is part of this kind of whole social justice movement that comes hand in hand with the climate change movement and suggestions that we're making. And the public information campaign is such an it's picked up a lot within the Children's Assembly as well, as kind of, you know, early, ready, keen learners. And it needs to be something that is run out across the board, through schools, through public establishments, public catering. And that's why we felt that the switching from public foods, public procured foods to plant-based and low carbon would be a really clear message from the government that would go hand in hand with an education programme. that would help set this change that is needed in our shift from the system that we're in at the moment to a fair, healthier, more sustainable future.
Thank you very much indeed, Ellie. I'm conscious of time, so I'll pass back to the moderator.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Natalie, I believe you have one more question.
Yes, I just wanted to go to land use. Sorry, I know two quite different topics. But I know in your response the comments in relation to community land ownership. And I'm just wanting to inquire how you feel that communities can be better supported to address the climate emergency. Do you believe that outright ownership of assets is the only way forward for this, or could better partnership working also achieve these goals? And what additional policies would the committee the Assembly like to see implemented?
I'll pass to Lewis for that one.
I think we've seen some really good examples. We heard some excellent evidence of cases where unused land was turned over to community ownership and was turned into a very positive and climate supporting use for growing land with food production. And that worked both in cities and in more rural areas. And I think I don't know whether the ownership of the land is going to be a key factor or not, but I think what was very important was that once land that can be used in that way has been identified, that we also consider the context of its use and make sure that we're not applying a blanket approach to this, and make sure that it is fit for purpose with regards to whether it's in a rural or an urban area.
Thank you very much indeed, Lewis. And that also speaks to one of the children's recommendations, where they were calling for more community gardens, and they didn't specify the land ownership model, but they were thinking about how they could perhaps use school sites to allow growing food and encouraging people to grow food and to learn how to grow food. So it was a very kind of comprehensive approach. It wasn't necessarily based on one single model of land ownership.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Okay, Natalie, thank you very much. I believe Liam Kerr has a brief final supplemental. Liam.
Yes, thank you, convener. Natalie and Monica asked about food production, quite rightly, and I thought that there was a recommendation of the Assembly around ending industrial fishing. Going back to the question about aviation, I just wonder if I might put the same thing here. What did the Assembly conclude around the just transition aspects of ending industrial fishing for those employed in that sector? And what did the Assembly conclude would be the impact of ending that on food supply and the price to those who perhaps have less to spend on food?
I'll pass to Ellie in a moment, but I would just note that some of the recommendations for industrial fishing also came from Children's Parliament, and particularly from children who were based on island communities, who were recognising both that there was an impact in terms of their biodiversity and the natural environment from the way that the land and the seas were being used. And the other thing that I would just point to is when members were making some of the recommendations around food, they really wanted to see local growing of food. So they were absolutely not saying that Scotland should not be an agricultural producer at all. They were saying what they wanted was to prioritise local growing of food. And also, just going back to some of the questions around taxation, they were talking about whether the taxation on high carbon food, and particularly things which were being perhaps flown in from overseas, so strawberries that were being flown in compared to strawberries grown around Dundee, that would be used to subsidise the low carbon food, and so increasing that price differential. But I'll pass back to Joan for a final word on that.
Again, I think you were talking about the skills of the workers. That's what I've picked up on. And again, it's education. It's fundamental. It's, you know, there's so many different areas that you, like Skills Development Scotland and using the Job Centre and stuff. And again, as I said, use the Climate Assembly. That's what we're sitting here for. But it's exploring what new opportunities would be there. And it's by bringing all these departments together.
Thank you very much, Joan. I think that's probably quite a good point to end on, the idea of using the Climate Assembly as a huge resource, and that commitment from the members for ongoing dialogue and engagement going forward.
Before we do end, could I ask one further question? The Assembly wants government to create a scorecard with KPIs, which personally I think is a very positive idea, to ensure measurement of these things. But why does the Assembly then feel that the reporting duties under things like NPF4 and other similar schemes are not adequate, are not going to deliver that measurement that we all want to see?
Liz, do you want to come in on that at all?
Yeah, I think our recommendations specify that the KPIs should be set by independent climate experts, and we think this is a very important part of the recommendation, because this ensures that we're benchmarking Scotland against other comparable nations and countries across the world, and that we're measuring ourselves in relevant metrics that are up to date on the climate change science. And particularly having that independence ensures that we're not allowing the government to cherry pick statistics that paint them in a good light or that highlights the positive work that they've done, which certainly exists. But we need these KPIs to be truly reflective of how Scotland is doing and how much better it could be doing. And for that to happen, we believe that the independent experts to be the ones to define those KPIs.
Thank you very much. Yes, I think that was very clear. And just the other thing to add is that the members were asking for a very accessible one-pager. And even just in the response that they got back from government, which was thorough and comprehensive, it was also extremely long and detailed and quite hard for people to get their heads around what the government response was. And so that's really why the idea of having a 10 graphic one-pager, which was updated twice a year, would allow everybody to be able to see whether government was on track or not with some of the things which, as the members have said earlier, they would have the expert advice on were the key indicators going forward for Scotland. But something which was very kind of accessible for everybody to look at with one pager rather than a 200-page report, which is often what we need to have from government. This was something slightly different than we're looking for.
Very grateful. Thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Okay, Liam, thank you very much. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. So let me thank the panel once again for joining us this morning, sharing your views on what the Scottish Government should be doing to tackle climate change. Thank you to you and the Assembly members for your many, many months of hard work. I know there have been work meetings during the evening, during the weekend, during lockdown. So your work is very much appreciated and valued. And we look forward to ongoing engagement between the committee and the Climate Assembly. Thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of your day. We now move straight on to our next item, which is Agenda Item 3, consideration of three negative instruments. The instruments are laid under the negative procedure, which means that their provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been laid. The first instrument is SSI 2022-8, Financial Assistance for Environmental Purposes, Scotland Order 2022. Do members have any comments on these instruments? There are no comments. I therefore invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to these instruments. Is that agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. The second instrument we are considering today is SSI 2022-9, the Scottish Roadworks Register Prescribed Fees Regulations 2022. Do members have any comments on these regulations? There are no comments. I therefore again invite the committee to agree it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are we agreed? That is agreed. And finally, the third instrument we are considering is SSI 2022-26, M8, M73, M74 motorways, 30 miles an hour, 40 miles an hour and 50 miles an hour speed limit regulations 2022. Again, do members have any comments on those regulations? There are no comments. I therefore invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are we agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. I now close the public part of this meeting. Thank you.